So, computing, it's become part and parcel of our daily lives. From how we communicate with each other, to how we consume media, to how we find a ride to the airport, right? Computers are obviously everywhere in our lives. What may not be so obvious is how computer programming has been integrated into how we work, how we do research, and how we create. Oftentimes, we have to tell computers how to solve specific problems for us, like to make our lives more efficient, or more informed, or better in some ways. And that means programming them. Programming is becoming more and more common outside of the typical computer science sphere. For example, I work with a biologist, and she writes her own software to run experiments or to analyze data. If you're a graphic designer, maybe you need to code to make an interactive animation or an installation. If you're a small business owner, perhaps you need the ability to make a custom website to have a greater online presence. In fact, the Association for Computing Machinery recently said that by the end of the decade, one out of every two science and technology-related jobs in the entire country will be in computing. In other words, computer programming is becoming a new literacy for the 21st century. Now, while programming has become integrated with the way that we work, these are the faces of the programming literate in the US, overwhelmingly white and Asian males. Now, whether that's because perceptions of programming culture as being negative or viewing programmers as nerdy or uncool, a vast portion of our population, especially women and many ethnic minorities, simply aren't interested in learning how to program. For example, 57% of the undergraduate degrees awarded in the US are to women. Yet, only 18% of computer science degrees are awarded to them. Similarly, 13% of our country is African American, yet less than 7% of computer science degrees are awarded to them. In other words, we have to do something about these socio-cultural barriers that are threatening to leave vast majorities of our population behind in a society that's becoming increasingly demanding of technological literacy. Now, researchers look at addressing this not only looking at what we teach in programming classes, but also how and in what context we teach it. The most successful projects have been ones that introduce a motivating context into programming, like artistic expression. For example, Ron Eglash's work in ethnocomputing, where he takes culturally motivated practices like hair braiding and mixes it with mathematics and computing concepts for African-American students. Or MIT's Scratch, which is used by young learners for introductory programming concepts related to making interactive animations. Or the LilyPad Arduino kit, which is this really cool combination of textile design and computing. However, as successful as these projects and others like them have been, none of them have had that broad appeal across ethnicity and gender for high school students. So my colleagues and I have considered this connection between creative expression and programming, and have considered music as a potential solution with broad appeal. Music is ubiquitous across cultures and socioeconomic barriers. It has a rich relationship with technology. Millions of people across the world use hobbyist software for making music, like GarageBand, while famous musicians like Jay-Z or The Beatles or Radiohead have a rich history with their music-making process being intertwined with new technologies. Now, music has been integrated with learning how to program before, but there's always the significant barrier of having to know music theory first. It's very difficult to express yourself with code in music if you don't know theory about how to write with individual notes and chords. So we asked, what about music remixing instead? Music remixing is when you take small snippets of audio from different samples and different songs and string them together to make something new. Like if you've ever heard Justin Bieber mixed with dubstep music, right? Or Led Zeppelin drum beat that is in your favorite Dr. Dre tune. Music producers can change how they sample sound by adding effects to them, making it sound more distorted or echoey or tinnier. You can also use a drum machine to add custom beats to the remix that you're making. So maybe combining programming with this composition of samples, beats, and effects could potentially sidestep this issue of having to learn music theory beforehand and getting learners up front coding and expressing themselves quickly. And this is exactly what we've been working in a learning environment called EarSketch. EarSketch is a free-to-use online tool for the combination of music remixing and programming, which we call computational music remixing. EarSketch has an online sample library that has thousands of samples from a wide variety of genres produced by music industry professionals. Students can also record their own samples on the site or even upload stuff they've recorded elsewhere. Students are really actually excited about laying down a few tracks by writing code and then recording their own vocals or instruments on top of it. It also has an online curriculum that chapter by chapter intertwines this idea of making music with introductory computing. The idea is that if you're a student and you've never programmed or made music before, you can sit down with EarSketch and start learning to do both in tandem. And finally, there's a programming environment seen at the bottom here where you can write in real programming languages like Python or JavaScript, and an audio window here at the top that shows the music that's made by it. So one of the big design challenges in building something like this is to have an authentic connection between making music and programming. So it's on us to show how programming can make music composition easier, more efficient, or even be more creative and expressive than making music without programming. So let's step through a few examples of this interconnection between music and programming in EarSketch. One topic we cover is data structures. Data structures are like the organizers for your program. So just like in your closet, if you have a specific place for your sweaters and your favorite jeans and your ties go here, data structures are the way that programs store information in a way that makes sense to us. If you want to write a program that uses data structures, it's just like writing a set of instructions for how to put away clothes in your closet. So, you know, in the first slot go the blue jeans, in the second slot go the sweaters, et cetera. In programming in EarSketch, we often use data structures as ways of holding collections of samples or musical rhythms that we want to use in our piece. This example here from this student, at the very top, you can see a couple data structures that are holding the samples that they're going to compose with later on in the code. Randomness. Randomness is a very common introductory programming concept that focuses on giving the computer the ability to make unexpected decisions by basically rolling dice inside. Just like if you're playing a board game and you roll dice for something unexpected to happen, or maybe consult your magic 8-ball to decide how to get to work today, right? So randomness in EarSketch is great for when you want to make a single program like this one, that generates rhythms. And when you run it multiple times, the computer rolls the dice and generates a new rhythm every time that you run it. So you can have one program and have multiple decisions being made randomly inside of it and have something new come out of it. For example, what we just heard here, if we literally don't change the code and run it again, this first rhythm track will visibly and audibly change. The last topic we'll cover is user-defined functions. So user-defined functions are just like having a recipe card for something that you use a lot in recipes that you write. So let's say you use pesto a lot in your recipes. As opposed to writing it down how to make pesto in every single recipe, you have one card, right? You have one card that says pesto, here's how I make pesto. And whenever I want to refer to it, I just write pesto in my recipe, right? So user-defined functions are exactly the same thing in your program, where you have some snippet of code that you want to use lots of places, instead of writing it down every single time, you just refer to it by name, like your pesto. So in music composition in EarSketch, one of the things that we do is focus on using user-defined functions for musical structure, musical sections. So you might have your chorus code and your verse code and your intro code. And whenever you want to have that stuff laid down on a track, you just refer to it by name, chorus, chorus, verse, etc. And it's these kinds of connections that we make, like through randomness or user-defined functions, that really start to show students how programming with music can be more efficient or easier to do in some ways, or more expressive. And the success of this work has led to over 30,000 learners so far using EarSketch in a variety of contexts. So in massively online courses, in AP computer science classes across the country, after-school workshops, summer workshops, et cetera. And our findings from using this have been overwhelmingly positive in terms of changing student attitudes towards computing, so addressing these sociocultural barriers that we're talking about, especially for these underrepresented groups. So the biggest effect that we've seen have been for women, African Americans, and Latinos. We have students saying things like, I like learning how music is made and how we can learn and get good at doing things that people in the music industry do now. Or, I enjoyed making my own music tracks that people, including myself, actually liked. Or, it gives me choices for college, like, this is something I would actually like to do for college, and I'd actually like to do probably with my life. Yeah, I would love to do it. And hearing this stuff is the stuff that keeps us going. So, by learning how to program, you're not just learning how to code. Students are also learning how to think about the world and solve problems in new ways. For example, learning how to program helps you understand how to take big problems and decompose them into smaller and smaller problems that are easier to solve. Or how to think algorithmically, which means the ability to write down specific instructions on how to solve complex tasks. Broader lessons in computing can even educate us about internet privacy, copyrights, or the socioeconomic impacts of technology. A student, not unlike the one who composed music that's playing right now, recently told me how he liked using EarSketch so much in his class that he actually brought it home to use in his band with his buddies. And you know, that's the kind of stuff that really represents the motivational power of EarSketch. We engage learners in ways that matter to them. Right? If we have students who are doing computer programming in their classes and bringing it home to share and show off to their friends and family, then we know we've succeeded in ways that we hadn't dreamed of possible. And through this, we're generating a new generation, we're creating a new generation of learners that is engaged in programming because they were given a tool to express themselves personally. And by doing so, we're broadening the future possibilities they have for the kinds of problems they solve, ideas they may have, or careers they may go into. And by doing so, maybe if EarSketch and other projects like it are as successful as we hope, then we're creating this new age of the programming literate that is far more diverse than anything we have now. And society, in turn, can benefit from this increased diversity of thought, values, and culture. And that is our ultimate dream. Thank you.